You know, today technology can do so many things. If you've seen me on Twitter, you know I love technology. Technology can do lots of things. I mean, we have cars and trucks that can drive themselves. We have grocery stores that you don't even need a human in to buy groceries, check out, and leave. There's no human working these grocery stores. So technology has come a long way, but what technology has yet to create is a human heart that fully functions. It can't create it. I do honestly think that maybe one day it might create a human heart that functions, but I don't know that it'll ever create a human heart in its entirety. And so I want to talk to you a little bit about being real. So when I was a little girl, I grew up in a less than stellar home life, and I absolutely loved school. It was my most favorite place to ever go, ever. But despite loving it so much, I struggled really bad in school, but the alternative to school was so much worse. So I loved going there. I had structure, I had hugs sometimes, and even if I didn't, I had smiles, and I had a hot meal two times a day. So I loved it. But unfortunately, the best thing I did at school was color pictures. I loved to color pictures, and I loved to play at recess and lunch. Those were like my best subjects. And reading and math and all those things that you're graded on were not. So I was struggling really bad in second grade, and then I met this angel. They call her my teacher. Her name was Mrs. Shelton. She was stellar. She asked us on the first day of school, we're like 7 years old, and she said, "What do you want to learn at the end of second grade?" I mean, you're seven, right? I don't know what the other kids said, but I knew that all my friends could read and I couldn't. And it was so frustrating. So I knew what I was going to tell her. But like all best teachers, she said, "Don't tell me your answer right now. I would like you just to hold that answer. And I want you to wait and tell me when you go out to recess." I could not wait for recess. So she got down on one knee as we're all going out to recess. And she's like, "Sweetie, what do you want to learn when you finish second grade?" And when this little face looked up to her, said, "I want to know how to read. I want to learn how to read." And she said, "You're going to learn how to read. Done." I was like, "You're seven, so you believe them, right?" You're like, "Done." Run off to recess, start playing. Unfortunately, it wasn't like a magic wand and boom, I knew how to read. She tutored me every single day when I got off the school bus. All I know is all the other kids had to sit outside in a line and didn't get to go into class until the bell rang, but I got to march right in. I got a big old hug, a snack, and I learned how to read. It was a hug and a snack, and I learned how to read. I really don't know the strategy she taught me to read, but all I know is that every day she showed me a lot of love, and she cared about me, and she took a little extra time. The best part about this story is I learned how to read that year, and I never, ever struggled in school again. Like 4.0, never struggled. I became the first generation graduate of anything in my family, and I honestly believe it was because of teachers like you that helped me do that. She changed the trajectory of my life by rewiring my brain, by telling me she believed in me. So R in real is being relatable. And it's so important that as educators, we are relatable. We make time to find out about our students, and we love them, and we show them that they can be something different, right? We change the trajectory of their life. You are that teacher. So don't forget that. But it's very important that no matter the standards and the demands that get put upon us as teachers, as educators, that we make time to be relatable. You can be relatable online, and you can be relatable in real life. It should feel like you just jumped out of Twitter. A lot of people will tell me that, "Tara, I think you just like jumped out of Twitter and now you're here, you're in real life." I want that to be the case. Like, so if you ever don't feel that way, let me know, because I need to change something. But you know, we might create a real human heart that's artificial. We might. But will we ever be able to create what Mrs. S did for me? Will technology ever be able to create that? I don't think so. So we need to be real, relatable. So let me tell you a little bit about being relatable. Recently, this is my boy. Love him. He's my heart. This is my boy Caleb, and he loves Snapchat. So if you came to some of my sessions, you probably got to hear a little bit about book snaps. He will snap morning, noon, and night. And I'm like, "Oh my gosh, you've got to stop that. Like, seriously, You spend too much time on there. But I figured out if you could take what the kids love, relate to them, right? Take what they love and use it for edu-awesomeness. And this is how BookSnaps came about. This is a very short version of BookSnaps. But I took it. I was like, hey, maybe I can take a digital visual representation with Snapchat. So all the things I would do with highlighting and taking notes in my book, I tried to recreate that digitally. And I called Caleb down. Hey, bub, come teach me how to use Snapchat. And he's like, no, you're old. Like, you should so never use Snapchat, Mom. This is not for you. And I'm like, no, let me tell you what I want to use it for. And so then he's like, hashtag ultimate nerd. He ended up making book snaps. It's okay. It's safe. But I said, you know, buddy, this visualization, this imagery that's happening in my mind, I want to recreate that with emojis and bitmojis because you guys love that. And I want to use what you guys love to learn. And he's like, just don't make them put it on their story, Mom. It's like a social buzzkill, like not on the story. So we save them and we upload them in another way. Don't put them on the story. It's a bad idea. But I created this book snap. And the first one I created was by Dave Burgess. He wrote Teach Like a Pirate. If you've never read it, you have to. Like right now, just go ahead and put it in your Amazon cart because it's really that good. And I made this book snap. I didn't really know what it was. So it was just like hashtag book snap, sent it out to my newfound Twitter. I had like 3 followers. And I only followed like 1 person, Adam Levine, and George because he taught me how to use Twitter. And other than that, I just sent it out to the world. And I called it hashtag book snaps. But when I did that, I tagged Dave Burgess because I'm like, oh, wow, he's a real human and he's on Twitter. And so later he commented on it and it blew me away. And that actually, Dave Burgess became an amplifier for me. He was the one who got all these eyes on this idea, this crazy, wild idea that was solving a problem that now kids all over the world are able to cannonball in and create book snaps and learn from them. And believe it or not, book snaps has brain science. If you are engaging both hemispheres of your brain, you have a very good chance of remembering this. So comprehension and reading takes place on the left side. Creation, right side, when you put them together, you have book snaps, and it's incredible because you actually remember the content. We have 17 countries now making book snaps. So no matter what, if you're the little girl with the crooked pigtails that comes from a broken home life, or you are the teenager that loves Snapchat, kids want to be related to. They want to know that you can relate to them. And sometimes, you know, like for me, I'm a hugger, so you might get a hug from me. But the truth is, kids, no. We don't learn from people we don't like. I love this sketch. If you see my book, well, we're going to draw for my book. But all the sketches are made by Carrie Buckham. She's at Heck Awesome on Twitter. And I love that she changed the quote by Pearson. She's like, forget that, not just kids. None of us want to learn from people we don't like, right? So be sure and shout her out if you snap, book snap anything in my book with the sketches. So the E, expose vulnerability. Man, that's a tough one. Nobody wants to expose vulnerability, but it's so important about being real. Like we post all these Facebook posts and we're like, let's remove all the eye wrinkles. And let's look like everything is perfect. But it's not. It's not perfect. And it's not that we want to glorify the problem. It's not really all about glorifying the problem, but it is about being all in. We have to understand there are victories and there are defeats. And I love the way Brené Brown puts it. It's understanding the necessity of both. It's engaging. It's being all in. So all in reminds me of my theory that's mentioned in my book called the Cannonball In Theory. It's just like it sounds. Just run and jump off the diving board. You're going to swim. Like, you know how to swim. Just try that crazy idea. Just try that engaging strategy for your kids. Jump in and swim like a mad woman or man all the way to the top and get over to the side. You're going to make it. And then when you get out, go back. Try something new again. So cannonball in and make waves. Exposing vulnerability is not about glorifying our problems. We don't need to post all of our quote unquote failures all over the place. No, we need to talk about what came next. Yeah, do we fall? Totally. But what came next? Laugh about that for a minute and then say, oh, but I tried this next. I learned from that. So exposing vulnerability is important, but it's all about flexing those muscles and trying again. Now let's go to approachable. A is for approachable. I think that you should always be approachable. I strongly believe that when somebody sees you for the first time, it shouldn't be like, oh my God, I'm kind of scared to walk over there and tell her hi. No, they should be attacking you in a hug for me, but maybe not for you. I know the East Coasters, they're like not so big on the hugging. When I went up north, I like tried to hug them. It was like stiff, like hugging this. I was like, oh, sorry, I can tell you're very uncomfortable. So approachable, though. Make sure that you feel like they can come to you. They can say hi to you. I talk a little bit about the approachability principles of a kickboxer. So dress for success. You just go in knowing you're going to own it. And sometimes in education, we just have to show up ready to do the work. We don't really even know if we're going to be able to cannonball in that day, but we're going to try it. And then never give up. There are times where I talk about, wow, I don't know if I can make it. 5 2-minute rounds, by the way, is like running a freaking marathon. It's crazy. It's not like it's as easy as it sounds. And so you just don't give up. You just keep trying. And same with your kiddos. When they're not getting it, we just keep going and we keep trying and we do it again. We do it again. We do it again. And when we bomb out, we don't hide. Why? Because we got to get up and go cannonball in again. It's what happens next. Don't hide when things fall apart. Don't hide when your parents are like, when the parents of your students are like, what are you even doing? Here's what we're doing, and this is why we're doing it. So, and smile through the pain. There are times where I know that we are taking on the burdens of our students, of the staff that we serve, and we just have to keep smiling, and we have to be the encourager even when we're beat, because that's what educators do. We are approachable. We are real. And so, the last one I want to talk about is L in real, learning through life. Everything is a learning experience, and that's what I love about life, everything. But I love this idea. I call it heart healthy salt. So basically, you know your why. My why is being real as a mom, being real as an educator, being real as a human. I want to be real no matter what I'm doing. So that is my why. But how I season the world is the inspiration. It is the heart healthy salt for my why. It's my what's. My what's can be writing. My what's can be talking to you right now. My what's can be having coffee with my buddy that's from Australia. My what's can be lots of different things, but they're always to share inspiration to reach my why, right? So what are your what's? Your what's are probably not the same thing as mine, and that's totally okay because that's your realness. No matter what your what's are, inspire the world, season the world with your heart healthy salt, and share your why. But not only that, we need to encourage kids. You be you. All the things that you are. I bring all these weird experiences, life experience. I bring all these weird strengths. I've been a kickboxer. Who does a kickboxer? I don't know. It's crazy. It's an interesting. Read the story. It's crazy. But you have all these interesting experiences that are unique to you. So do your children. So do your students. So does your staff. Let them be all the things that they are and bring their realness to inspire the world to understand, like, all these things are necessary to make us a collective whole, right? So if we can all just be real, inspire others with our what's, then I really think that's what the world needs. That's what education needs. If any field out in the world needs to be real, it's educators, because we're raising the next generation who sees a lot of fake news, a lot of fake everything. We want to encourage them to be real. So I read a book. I'm seasoned in the world with this book. We'll see. The world. It's kind of like my Twitter world, right? I'm seasoned in the world with this book. I want them to understand that being real is very much a part of what we do. So go out, encourage the world, be real, and encourage others, empower others to be real.